My name is Robert Joseph Stark. I have 20 acres of land here that I purchased in May of 2012. And it came with a beautiful cabin you'll see soon. It's all off the grid. And yeah, we're just trying to turn it into a farm, slowly but surely. And you'll see there's a lot of jobs that haven't been completed because either one, I'm a little lazy or procrastinate in certain areas, or two, I don't have the skill yet and I don't want to pay people. So we're trying to do things as cheap as possible while also not, you know, make the quality poor. Here we'll start with all this here was some trees and stumps and this brush that was overgrown. And when I first bought it, it was coming through with the weed whacker, chainsaw, shovel, digging up as many stumps, roots, fireweed, little trees, birch trees that we could, and doing our best to clear it out. And I only got so far until finally my neighbor, who had traded a Rottweiler puppy for time with the excavator, drove over in the excavator and he plowed it for us. And he made that berm over there on the eastern side of the property. And yeah, really made it what it is. If it wasn't for that guy, we couldn't have it. So it turned into our vegetable garden this year. We planted perennial fruit trees, apples on the outside, the south side over here, different varieties, a Red Harrelson variety, and Wolf River from Wisconsin and Minnesota. I bought all the trees that you see here from one orchard down in Onalaska, Washington. When I was going to college before at Evergreen for sustainable agriculture, we toured this guy's farm. And he just had the most beautiful edible forest with hazelnuts down to apples and cherries to strawberries and canes. I mean, everything you saw pretty much you could eat. And I really trusted him. He said these are all really hardy varieties. Yeah, we do all of our ordering from him, so. Then here we have the vegetable garden. We weren't planning to do this many vegetables this year. We were just gonna work on the fruits, but we had the space, so we figured why not. Under here, we have our beets. You know, this here is a Rimei. It's a fabric woven cloth that is used to trap moisture, heat, and humidity in the garden beds. I've seen the difference. I haven't used it before on my own growing. I did when I worked on farms in Washington, but I wanted to keep it natural and not have that look. But man, I swear by it now. The difference in my beets here that you see, you know, these little guys, which of course they're still not as nice as some that people have, but they're growing. Then you'll see on this other bed over here, we have beets that we planted 10 days before and they're not even half the size. This Rimei really works. So we got the Rimei on most of our beds. Here's the beets, cabbage, got Brussels sprouts. And then behind the Brussels sprouts, those are carrots, which we've had a little spottiness with the carrots, but they're gonna be all right. And then we got two rows of potatoes. We grew these potatoes last year and then we saved the seeds. And it was our first time saving the seeds and replanting them, and I was a little worried about how they were gonna do, but they're doing great. We got three different varieties, red, purple, and white, and we'll use these to eat for the winter, you know, and save some for next season and give some out, maybe sell a little bit to a brewery, they'll buy them. So yeah, and then over here we got radishes. We just did a big harvest of them yesterday that we sold to some people in Seward, as well as this restaurant. And then see, these are the tiny beets. See these guys?
Oh, they're so small.
I mean, horsetail, get out of here. They're nothing compared to the ones under the Rimei.
Wow.
You know, really. And I think it may also be because they're close to the radishes, but it shouldn't be that big of a detriment to their health, honest to God, so. And then we got the peas on the background growing up. They're looking all right. Hopefully here in the next couple weeks, we'll start getting some peas. Kind of consider ourselves fall farmers this year, because we're really not harvesting much right now, you know, some radishes and chives and things, but hopefully come fall we'll be doing pretty good. These are some elderberries. We do have natural elderberries that are here on the land, but we wanted more. We wanted to sell some berries to, there's a winery in town, and hopefully other people, we'll just see what happens. This is one of the apples I thought wasn't gonna make it, so it doesn't look that great. But still, I think it is gonna make it. Yarrow, that's my favorite plant. Then we got comfrey, you know, that's another, it's what they call a biomass accumulator, being that it's a perennial plant that grows up nice and hardy, produces a lot of material that we can use in our compost, as well as it's a bee attractant. You'll see on nice days, you know, the bees seem to be pretty lazy today. Yeah, the bees will come in and they'll just get all over this stuff. And of course, daisies, because they're beautiful. Again, we got the apple, a pear tree, which people have been asking, do they grow pears in Alaska? And so far, I don't know of anyone growing pears in Alaska, even up at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. But, you know, we're going to try. We're going to try. I mean, the way I see it, one of these pear trees, we have four. One of them was $25. $25, you know? I mean, that's if you drink, which I don't anymore. $25, five beers, you know what I mean? I mean, I spent a lot of nights spending $25. So I see it as four $25 investments. If it doesn't really work out, well, that's all right. But if it does, I think, yeah, that'll be a wonderful thing. So they're Asian pears. That's what the guy told me. He thought they'd do better than the European. I'm really taking his advice. We got the elderberries again. So this is kind of like a, it's like a north, this is the north side of our property. So that's why we've planted the trees on this north side with intentions of them growing tall, kind of being a little bit of a windbreak from the wind that way, as well as a windbreak for that side from the wind this way. And then on the south side of our property over there, we have that row of trees. And in between them, we have rhubarb. And we're hoping that the apples will grow up there and not too tall so they don't provide shade, but enough to provide a little bit of a windbreak. You know, we're trying to really make this garden environment a nice, moist, wind-free as much as possible environment, you know, with behind it, the trees. So that's what we're going for. So then we've also scattered a bunch of seeds as cover crops. You know, a cover crop is what farmers use to protect their soil, to replenish the minerals and nutrients that they use each season. All this stuff that was either bare, or this here's the horsetail again, and there's grasses, you know? We've done our best to plant clover, and you know, it's coming up in patches, man, but as the years go by, I think it'll get thicker and thicker and thicker, and the clover is a nitrogen-fixing plant. Another apple, you know, Gravenstein. That's my homie. I think it's probably the best one that's been going on so far. I read this article the other day from this guy. His name, I believe, is Michael Phillips. He wrote a book called The Organic Orchardist. He was like the guy for growing fruit, and he was saying that no matter what year your plants are when you put them in the ground, to expect to wait like 7 years for your apples to produce. He laughed and said, you know, it's not for impatient gardeners. We're trying to stay patient, you know. They're pretty small, but last year was their second year alive. This is their third year. And as time goes on, they're gonna get bigger, and we can only cross our fingers and hope they produce some fruit for us, you know. So around here, similar things, you know, we got oak tree. We're trying, you know. Don't know if it's gonna work, but we're gonna try. Raspberry rhubarb. This is a butternut, so it's a different type of nut tree that man Michael told me would work really well here. Honest to God, I never seen a butternut. I don't know what it looks like, but I hope we get some, man. Yeah, more raspberries. So the hope, you know, of course, we plant these in hopes that the rhubarb grow big, and then we can propagate them, divide them, and move them to other areas. So in the end, we can have tons of rhubarb and raspberries that we can sell as well as can. Oak tree. Another thing we're trying to do is not destroy all the natural landscape that's here. We're trying to work with the natural landscape, which is why we haven't just cleared all the trees and all the roots and everything. We're just trying to work around it, you know, saving us a lot of money, a lot of energy, and it's providing homes for all the birds and bugs and all the beautiful things that are here. Yep, we got another nut tree here, little McDonald. I envision it growing huge and taking this thing over, producing a bunch of hazelnuts. Another little rhubarb. Here's the worker we got helping us this year, Levi. He's a great young man. Couldn't ask for better help. He's working on our solar panel stand here. The PVC stand, which Levi made, he's a plumber, cost $7, you know, because we had a bunch of scrap sitting around. He did buy this plywood, which was $71. All in all, I mean, for the solar panels, this charge controller, which we have, which tells you how much you're getting in, which right now we're not getting anything, but our charge is at 99%. We do need to, I told Levi too, we gotta orient them a little bit more south. You know, we charge all of our stuff with this, is what it comes down to. Our phones, our computers, anything that needs a charge, this is how we charge it. Inside here is where the plan is to put the battery bank. You know, it'll be waterproof and it'll be protected from the elements for the winter. Right now it's just that one little battery. Yeah, man, so that's the solar panel stand. So we got more nut trees here, which we're crossing our fingers, just like the pears. People can laugh, and that's fine. Maybe sometime we'll get nuts. If we do, we'll be roasting a lot of nuts on a fire. Let me tell you. We also got some redwood trees we bought this year, all from that same guy, you know. This is our compost right now. Sorry, it looks a little kind of corn husky, but so this is all grass that we cut yesterday and the day before mowing everything, and a lot of it's got clover and grasses and vetch and things, and this is part of a compost that we had last year from chicken manure and all kinds of stuff that we've just been adding and adding and adding stuff to. Thankfully for my education, my college education, which was paid for by the military, I wouldn't have went if it wasn't for that. I did learn a little bit about composting. I do understand the carbon and nitrogen ratio a little bit. Nothing here is scientific, but we are doing our best to layer. You know, you got your carbon, which is like your brown material, you know, and that takes longer to break down. And then you got your nitrogen, which is like your manure, your grasses, your green material. So as you see here, there's little clover, you know, that's taken up again. This was all really hard packed, you know, and we're crossing our fingers, hoping we can get a nice clover zone at some point. The fireweeds, beautiful background for us. Here we got apple trees, the Wolf River, and then the apples go around that way. We got some rhubarb, you know, that we propagated. A couple haven't made it, but you see here, this is one little guy. So you got the rhubarb plant. It's a big plant. It's got all these roots. Well, if you kind of look a little closer, which I'll show you with the rhubarb, I suppose, there's all these little crowns. And what you do is you take your little pruners and you cut those crowns, and then you bring a crown and you plant it. And then you bring a crown and you plant it. And that one rhubarb plant, all of my rhubarb plants, which now last year was 12 after propagating and stuff, probably got like 30. Came from one plant. We're gonna go up here to the house here in a second. One thing I did forget to mention about the garden area is that we do not have a tiller. We don't have a tractor. What we do have are hand tools and some really strong, lean bodies. So we did all this stuff by hand, you know, which ain't that big a deal to a lot of people, but we got this awesome tool from a thrift store in Homer that was built by this guy, this woman's grandfather. She used it in Homer for a lot of years, or he did actually. And then he was retiring from farming, so he lent it to, well, he gave it to us. That's what we've used to build our beds and to hoe and pretty much till the land. So yeah, now we'll go forward. We just got this four-wheeler this year, which has been used so far as a really great entertainment source of entertainment. I guess I haven't quite used it yet for a tool. Right now there's some cedars in this tarp that I was going to bring to the other property, on the other side of the property. This is my sweet little economical car that gets like 30, 40, I don't even know. It seems like forever miles to the gallon. Inherited it from my mama. She just passed away here last October. This is the work truck we use for all kinds of stuff, whether it's going kayaking or getting wood or whatever it is, man, it's the truck. This was, I don't mean to be a junkyard, but this is an old Volkswagen this guy gave me. He gave it to me and I was just thrilled. I was like, oh yeah, yeah, let's do this. I want to be a Volkswagen over. And I was driving it home and everybody was flying by me, you know. And I learned probably after like the 10th time of driving it that I don't really like driving really slow and always worrying about it breaking down. So I parked it and used it for storage for one winter, and then it kind of became the storage unit. And yeah, the neighbor wants to trade me. He's got a little wood mill. We're gonna be doing some trading here in the next little bit. He wants to give me some lumber and he wants the van for his daughter, I guess. And I'm just kind of waiting for him to come and get it, you know what I mean? So here's the other part, you know, we're getting to the house and the yard and everything. When we first got this place, there was the house. It was roughed in. There was no heat. The well, we had well and septic. The well was direct laid PVC pipe that was not withstandable to winters here in Alaska. First thing we had to do is dig a trench that goes from the well, which is like 123 feet to the house at 4 to 5 feet. We got that dug, got new piping, not PVC, this beautiful PEX. Got that installed, pitless adapter. And then that goes from the well to the house where it goes up into a 65 gallon storage tank that warms with the wood heat and then is gravity fed. You know, we pump the well, we get all of our water, and then it's all gravity fed. In this summer where we've been watering all of these plants and things, we've probably used I would say a maximum of 3 gallons of fuel for all of our water. You know, it's really efficient. It's a 5700 McCulloch generator that we got with the house. And we also run a 1000-watt Mitsubishi when we want to watch movies and things. I mean, people come over all the time, you know, and no offense to any of them, but they come over when I didn't have the panels and be like, when are you going to get panels? What about all the wind out here? You need a wind generator. And I'm like, dude, I spend like maybe $2 to $4 a week on my energy bills before the solar panels. Like I use wood heat, like, but you can't really explain that to people, you know, they don't want to listen. They're like, oh, whatever, just get. And it's like, all right, well, I don't really want to spend the $900 for this stuff or whatever, you know? So, but hopefully at some point, you know, we would love to not have to run the generator for the well. And, but in the meantime, it's just, it's great. Very first morning I woke up, I came out, it was sunny, and I stretched, and I was like, oh, you guys, it feels good. And they're like, what? What feels good? And I was like, you know, I'm not trying to brag. I tell everybody who stays here this. And they're like, what? I was like, well, I didn't spend any money last night while I slept, you know? Not a single dollar. I mean, people who live on the grid, I mean, unless you have some way to turn it off, which most people don't, you know, you're spending money as you sleep. And I think that's really problematic when it comes to having to work so much just to pay your bills. So we love the off the grid. Turn it off, turn it on when you want it, man. And that's it. This here's rhubarb. Yeah, the rhubarb beds, you know, same thing. They're only a couple years old. We've harvested them strong this year because Miguel makes an amazing cream pie. Yeah, the rhubarb's doing pretty good. Pretty good. These are our chives, you know, there ain't much of them right now. Little purple ones there too, but we've harvested them and stored some as well as sold some. These are our little strawberries. Same type of thing. They were eaten down last year by the chickens as well as the raspberries and the rhubarb, and now they're coming back. So we think that as future goes on, you know, it'll just get better and better. We got little strawberries forming now. Obviously it takes some time weeding, you know, it's not always like this. All this horsetail grows and grows and grows. We got peas planted, interspersed. Because they are nitrogen fixers, they do bring nitrogen to the soil. We can also eat them as we go, but on the outside here, we got peas growing up the Sainer's net, which you can get in abundance for a good price. Being that we live next to a fishing community, there's always a bunch of Sainer's net around. Yeah, and raspberries, you know, little guys are starting to form. We got an abundance of bees. Wish we had more for you guys to see, but it's rainy. We got these strawberries I'm tempted to eat. Our rain barrel, which is working as we speak. We just put it up the other day, this gutter. And man, you'd be surprised how quick that thing fills up. It's actually becoming a problem that it overflows so much. Yeah, but here in time, we're gonna do all of it, you know. So far, we just got this side and the other side that are done. And then, man, what a difference it makes to be able to walk from here to there and be collecting. And, you know, obviously it's pretty big deal. So yeah, we use this water for watering all of our plants. We water the plants this water. When we don't have, or if like we just run the well, I mean, that water comes out of the well, it's cold, man. The plants don't like that. So a lot of times we do the rainwater, and when we water with this, we fill these two, you know? Before we got this all set up, it was probably like a week ago, we finally got it set up where we can water everything from the well water that's stored up there. But before that, and even now, we just collect the water, we fill these up, and we hand water. Or we'll use them, you know, I'll boil it up and use it to do dishes, sometimes not boil it. Most of the time, not boil it. I do my dishes. Yeah, but I generally use it for watering plants. This is our young orchard. You know, this is the first year we put most of these trees in. The ones on the far end down there, it's their second year. They were our experimentals. And since they made it and they look good, we decided to go with the more. We got 40 more apple trees this year to go with the 12 from last year. Yeah, there's just a whole bunch of different varieties, you know? Gravenstein, Battleford, Parkland, Spartan, Red Harrelson, like I said, Honeycrisp. I mean, the list goes on. There's multiple varieties, and we're trying to learn, you know, from the potato famine in Ireland that we don't want to plant all the same variety, man. We don't want a pest that loves one variety of plant to come through and wipe us out. So we're doing our best to plant different varieties, see which ones produce the best here in Alaska in our environment, And then in the future, we will invest more of our time, money, and energy into those trees. But in the meantime, you know, right now it's this experimental thing. We still have some trees in the area, in the orchard. You know, we're torn whether to cut them or keep them. I wrote an article once for the newspaper that was to cut or to keep, because I cut down a big birch tree that blocked our view of a volcano, Mount Redoubt. Yeah, my girl was happy. She could see the volcano from the kitchen, you know. But we're still in that same situation, you know, all the time wondering what we should cut, what we should keep. And if it ends up that these trees are having problems, or, which I don't think they're going to, man. I think it's gonna be just fine. This birch tree, you know, it could go down, we could get some more sunlight. Over here, we got this, what I like to call the cook henlet. It's our chicken coop. So my girlfriend last year was like, hey, Robert, you know, this is before I went to a carpentry avtech class, which I still don't know what I'm doing. Anyways, my girl was like, hey, this girl's giving us chickens, we need a coop by tomorrow. I was like, oh God. All right, I didn't know what to build. And we had all this scrap material under our deck that we used to build the house. And it had been sitting there for like 2 years. So I just pieced something together and it worked, man. It worked really great. We had the chickens in here for one winter. We didn't have a heat light. We would have a heat light again if we did it again, because they were getting a little bit of damage up here on their crowns. And they were getting a little frostbite damage, but we took a woman's advice who owned Wagon Wheel and Homer, who said that all you need to do is just put a thick layer of straw down, let them poop. Thick layer of straw on top of sawdust. Thick layer of straw, let them poop. Thick, and you keep doing that, and all through the winter, I mean, by the time we took all the straw in the springtime, none of our birds had died. Man, we had like a thick cake of like the best compostable manure and straw combination, which we used in the gardens. But yeah, if next time we get chickens, we do want to get a little light, you know. We will have a little battery for them on them really cold winter nights. But what I am most fond of is this little thing. You know, I'm not a builder, I'm a finder. And I found this when I was cutting wood, and that was like the easiest door latch ever, man. But yeah, so that's the cook henlet. This is our septic leach field area, so we're not planting any food on here. It's just clover. You know, what you can see has been coming up. So, you know, like I said before, this is all hard packed, man. Especially this, because the guy had just brought in machinery, done all the work. And so, yeah, I mean, we didn't do most of this. This is Mother Earth coming back and being like, give me that. But we have planted some clovers and things. Yeah, this is kind of our border, you know, for our first little go ahead. This is what we're going to work with. We're gonna try our best to maintain all these plants and trees. And then as time goes on, yeah, we'll clear out some more land and do more planting, and hopefully they all produce, and we can, I don't know, not only store food, but sell a little bit to make some money.